Hi everyone, Aaron here for zollotech, and today Apple released iOS 15.1 Beta 2. This is available to developers and hopefully soon to public beta testers. Usually by the time this video is live, it's available. If not, it will be the following day. Now this came in at 944.9 megabytes. That's on the iPhone 13 Pro Max, but it varied anywhere from about 600 megabytes or so on the iPhone 6S Plus to around almost 1 gigabyte on the 13 Pro Max. Now they also released iPadOS 15.1 Beta 2, as well as watchOS 8.1 Beta 2 and tvOS 15.1 Beta 2, but there is no macOS Monterey yet, which is a little bit disappointing because a lot of us want to try out that new universal control and we need that to do it. So we'll have to wait a little bit longer for that. Now let's take a look at the build number and talk about what's new. So we'll go to settings, then we'll go to general, then we'll go to about. And as you can see, it says 15.1. If you tap on the software version, it says the build number is 19B5052F. And this particular build is not super close to the final release unless Apple has different plans. But usually when we get closer to an A, we get closer to a final build, although that's not always 100% of the time. Now we also do have a modem firmware update, and you can see it says 1.14.01, and that's the current firmware update for iOS 15.1 Beta 2, at least on the Pro Max. It's not updated on all of the phones here. In fact, the 12 Pro and 12 Pro Max, some people are saying they're not seeing a modem update. So it just depends on the phone that you're using. Now, Apple released a major update to Keynote, Numbers, and Pages. Those are their iWork suite of applications, and there's huge updates here. It's the equivalent of Microsoft Word and Excel and PowerPoint, but some of them have some nicer features and they've added a ton to it. So those are available now. Now, a lot of people were asking me about vaccination cards being added to the wallet. Well, the code is there, but you first have to have the vaccination proof within your health app. So if you're in the health app and you have a supported app that works with health. So there's a couple steps to this. So you need to have an application that can verify it. So maybe you're in a state that supports it. Then you can have an application that verifies it and will allow you to add it to the health app. Once it's in the health app, it will now see that information and allow you to add it to the wallet app. Now the code is all there for it. Thanks to my friend, Steve Mosier, for finding that. And the code is there for it, but whether or not it pops up, I can't say because we don't have the application in this state that I live. So there's no way to verify vaccination or immunization and have that show up. But if you're in a supporting state, it's possible it's there already. So if you're in California and you have that, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. Now, as far as anything else that's new, well, there's no forward-facing features that we can see. No physical changes, nothing like that. But there are a few bug fixes that are pretty important. So as I mentioned before, no universal control with the iPad yet that allows you to use a mouse or maybe a trackpad to control the iPad and a Mac. That will be coming a little bit later, hopefully. But as far as new features or bug fixes, Apple has fixed the issue with unlocking your iPhone when your face is obstructed, whether that be a mask or something else, and you're using an Apple Watch. They've fixed that issue and it now works. So I'll lock my phone, then I'll obscure my face and then unlock it. So it will unlock and it'll use my wrist to do that. And it says unlocked by this Apple Watch. That issue has been fixed. Now, for me, it was working fine on 15.1 Beta 1, but a lot of people were having that issue. And so it's resolved for everyone else. So if you were having that issue and it's still not working, make sure you have a passcode turned on your Apple Watch, as you'll need that to unlock your phone. It requires that just for security reasons. So you need to have a passcode on the watch, then set up that feature in your Face ID settings. Just turn on the switch by going to settings, and then you go over to Face ID and passcodes. Once you've entered your passcode, you can see it says unlock with Apple Watch, Aaron's Apple Watch. Just make sure that's turned on and you'll be good to go and it should work. So thankfully that's working. And I know that was a huge pain for a lot of people. Another thing I noticed that seems to be better is the touch bug or the touch input bug, where you would touch something, whether that be a YouTube video or just an app. And sometimes it wouldn't do anything. You'd have to touch a video in YouTube about 30 times sometimes, or just close the app altogether. Those issues seem to be fixed so far in this beta, at least in my little amount testing it since it's been out, it seems to be much better. And so that's been fixed. The storage bug, though, is still there. So if you go into your settings under general and then iPhone storage, the storage bug is there for some people where it's giving odd storage numbers, whether that be for system data. Although it's correct on the 13 Pro Max, it's not always correct on every device. So this is an iPhone 12 Pro that's running beta 1. So I can hopefully show you the storage bug here. We'll let it load. And there we go. This one seems to be okay, but not every one of them are. Sometimes it would be 0 gigabytes, or it would be saying that you have a ton used, even though you don't, or that you had more storage than you actually have. So there's a lot of odd little bugs still in there, and people are still reporting that in this update. Now, as far as resolved issues and known issues, well, Apple has mentioned a few. Resolved issues have to do with the new iPad mini. So if you have a new iPad mini, I don't have one here, I just have my iPad Pro. So if you have an iPad mini, there's a setting in here that has to do with Safari to improve legibility. Maybe this has to do with some of the jelly scrolling issues people are reporting on the iPad mini, but basically they've said on the iPad mini sixth generation, websites now load with the iPad mobile user agent by default to improve text legibility. So what that means is when you go to a website, it will load the mobile version first. On the iPad Pro, if you go into your settings, go down to Safari, under Safari, scroll down, you'll see it says request desktop website. This will be turned off by default. You'll have to turn that on by default or turn that on yourself on the new iPad. So it's just something they've changed, and maybe it has to do with the actual scaling of the new iPad itself. Now, as far as resolved issues that are there, that's the only thing they mention. However, there are 5 known issues that still remain. Matter notifications. So Matter has to do with controlling your home, and it's a new standard that Apple's working on and will work with others, but the notifications for applications or for devices that use Matter are not working properly. And they could work after you reboot, but they're just not working properly all the time. The other issue they've mentioned is if you're using accessibility features for VoiceOver. So if you're under accessibility and you're using the VoiceOver feature, there can be an issue where you may not be able to activate the alarm in the clock app. So if you have an alarm in your clock and you're trying to set it with VoiceOver, that may not be working for you in this beta. So if that's really important, you may want to skip the beta. And so that leads me to, should you install iOS 15 beta 2? Well, if you're on beta 1, you'll see improvements for sure. Of course, that Face ID unlock will be improved. But if you're not on the beta program, you may want to stay on iOS 15 until they release this as a public update, because I don't generally recommend going to public or beta versions to fix problems with public updates. Generally, I recommend waiting until the final version is out to the public so it's much more stable. Now, as far as iOS 15.0.1, people have been asking me, is this going to come out? We really don't know. Apple has said nothing about this, and many people suspected, due to the watch issue and some other issues with iPhone 13, that they would release maybe an interim update. But right now we know nothing about that. So if they do release it, I would expect it soon. Otherwise, I would see maybe if we have an iOS 15.1 beta 3 next week or the week after, and a final release, usually within a month of the release of iOS 15. That's what Apple did last time. So they released it on the 20th, maybe on the 11th, we'll have a new update to iOS 15.1. That's what they did with iOS 14. And then they started releasing a ton of updates. So we could see the same sort of rollout, or they might change it altogether. Apple has been very random with updates overall. Now, as far as battery life, that will take a few days to measure. I can show you my battery life on the 13 Pro Max, which is really impressive so far. Battery health on a new device should be 100%, but you'll see over the last 6 days, yesterday I used 50% of my battery and I had 5 hours and 33 minutes of screen on time, 6 hours and 3 minutes of screen off time. I used it for the phone for 33% of the time. I had to make a lot of phone calls yesterday, and that means I'd get 11 hours of screen on time, just continuing to use it throughout the day if you went to another 50% usage, and that was on beta 1. So the overall battery life of the 13 Pro Max is incredibly impressive compared to the 12 Pro Max and even the 11 Pro Max. So far, it's been incredible. So it just depends on the day. You'll see a couple days ago, 6 hours and 16 minutes of screen on time, and I used just over 50%. So I'm getting amazing battery life on this. And of course, I'll be doing a review of the iPhone 13 Pro Max and have some other tips about it fairly soon. Now, as far as performance, I did notice that after I booted up the iPhone 6S Plus, that performance was a little sluggish at first. The widgets would not fill in. And that was a bug before, but it did fill in, so it worked properly. And initially it was quite warm. Now that's typical after you install an update, but right now it's cool to the touch, and it's only about probably 10 minutes since it installed and since I've even run Geekbench on here. So it's actually doing quite well as far as temperature wise goes. So it's doing well there. I don't really expect any issues with it, and performance seems to be what you would expect. Maybe even better than before because there were those touch issues that I talked about. So it seems to have fixed a lot of those bugs. Of course, it takes time to fix all the bugs, and if you're still having issues, make sure to report them in feedback. Now let's take a look at the Geekbench scores. Now on the 13 Pro Max, it was the first time I ever ran a Geekbench score, and you'll see it scored 1,735 and for multi-core 4,732. I don't really have a history here on this specific device, but we can look at the previous device where we're up quite a bit. So on my 12 Pro Max, which this was run on, it's synced across it with iOS 15.1 beta 1. It shows, of course, it's going to be much faster on the new A15 Bionic, but this just gives you a general idea. Now, I did run it on most of these devices here. This device has beta 1 on it, so I didn't run it on the 12 Pro, but let's take a look at the 11 and the 6S Plus and iPad. So from left to right, I have the iPad Pro 12.9 from 2021, then the iPhone 6S Plus, the iPhone 11, and the iPhone 13 Pro Max. Again, this gives you a general idea of what to expect, and I'd love to hear from you if you want me to include the Geekbench scores in beta updates or not. Some people find them useful, some don't. I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. Now, iOS 15.1 beta 2 seems pretty feature complete at this point and fairly stable, at least for the past hour I've used it. It will take a few days to measure, and usually I'll do a follow-up on the weekend. So be sure to look for that. Unless we have a ton of other things coming out, be sure to look for that follow-up. Now, if you've found anything else in beta 2, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. And of course, I'll link this wallpaper in the description like I normally do. If you haven't subscribed already though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.